relate to experience, which is a basic empiricist theme. And he was sure that they were right about that. He was as reluctant as they were to countenance the idea of conclusions about things that utterly transcended our experience. For example, he had no patience at all with attempts to prove the existence of a transcendent God, or with speculations about an afterlife, for example, what might happen to us after our deaths. When these were understood as attempts to come again at substantive knowledge, I mean, he didn't feel that we could have knowledge about these things at all. He was sympathetic to attempts to think in those terms and to speculate about those things, but he was of a mind with the empiricists in denying that we could know anything about those realities beyond our experience. So in that sense, he was very much in line with them, as against the rationalists. He agreed that all our knowledge must ultimately relate to experience and be grounded in experience. But he didn't think that it was all simply read off from experience. He thought that when we derived knowledge of the world through the deliverances of experience, it was because we ourselves were appropriately receptive to what was out there. And being appropriately receptive meant having certain faculties in terms of which we interpreted what was out there, certain faculties that enabled us to make sense of what was out there. And an analogy that is often used in this connection, it's not Kant's own analogy, but it's quite a useful analogy, is that it's as if we were operating with a pair of spectacles, epistemological spectacles, through which we interpret what the world throws at us, as it were. But these spectacles are unlike ordinary spectacles in that we can never take them off. I mean, everything that we know through this basic framework. They provide a kind of structure for what we know, a framework, as I say, through which we interpret things. That is where the element of idealism lies, because we ourselves are making a contribution to the shape of our experiences. The reason why Kant wanted to call it transcendental idealism, saw it as a special kind of idealism, was that we could never take our spectacles off. There was no such thing as taking our specs off and stepping back and looking at this process as it was in itself. We were always constrained to see things through this basic framework. And that's why he felt that it was appropriate to distance himself, for example, from Berkeley, whose view was also obviously an idealist view, but who felt that the idealistic processes that were giving us knowledge were themselves things that we could reflect on and come to know about.
Kant later attempted to justify the various principles according to which objective experience must be organized. In the section of the Critique of Pure Reason called the Dialectic, Kant explores his own theory of ideas, which are pure concepts of reason. Because we have reason, we naturally have these ideas. Kant also dealt with ethics and morals. Nothing in the world, indeed nothing even beyond the world, can possibly be conceived which can be called good without qualification, except a good will.
What Kant means by a good will is a will that's exercised in complete accord with its own freedom. That's to say, a will that is, in a popular phrase that's often used in this connection, a will that's a law unto itself. It's following its own principles, its own rules, its own laws. And those laws, Kant believes, he has all sorts of interesting arguments to substantiate this belief, those laws are the laws of morality. a good will is a will that acts on principle, purely for the sake of principle, doing what it does simply because that's the right and proper thing to do, that's the law governed thing to do, and doing that in turn simply because it's acting in accord with its own laws, that is to say, it's acting in a way that's completely autonomous and free. So a good will is a will that's, if you like, obeying the laws of its own freedom. And that has important resonances for Kant, because that in turn is a will that is completely moral in its determinations, in its behaviour, in the behaviour that it causes.
In the Critique of Judgment, Kant explores how our aesthetic judgments depend upon the interplay of imagination and understanding. Kant lived for 80 years, but never married. During that time, he never strayed far from his native Königsberg, but his philosophy was to influence the whole world.
In modern philosophy, Kant's influence is second only to that of Descartes. So the defining moment of the beginning of modern philosophy is Descartes' Meditations. Then the defining moment of later modern philosophy is Kant's Critique of Pure Reason. Mm-hmm. And Kant's influence is, in the 19th century, he spawns a whole idealistic, romantic movement in philosophy, unintentionally. In the 20th century, he's very influential in ethics, but also in political theory.
I mean, he's had an absolutely immense influence in general, and specifically on subsequent philosophers. His general influence has to do with the various Enlightenment ideals that he championed. He's a major figure in the Enlightenment, and we all know what kind of an influence that in turn had. He helped to put reason back on the map. He was able to champion reason and to give a compelling account of how much reason is able to achieve, how much human beings are able to achieve through the use of reason, through being purely rational, which is obviously a very important Enlightenment theme. And in particular, in his views about moral philosophy, he was able to give, again, a very compelling account of how far we're able to get in distinguishing between right and wrong simply by using our own natural, rational resources without having to appeal to authority, and in particular without having to appeal to the authority of religion. So that's a huge Enlightenment impact that he's had. But also specifically on philosophers, I mean, there's virtually no philosophy that has come since, in the 200 years since Kant died, that has not in some way been influenced by Kant. Very few people nowadays are straightforward Kantians. It's not that kind of influence. And people that see things in a very non-Kantian way still recognise the force of his arguments and the strength of his position and see it as something that they have to respond to. So he's pretty much shaped the whole nature of subsequent philosophical discussion, set the parameters, determined what it is that people feel that they have to discuss, what the main issues are, what the main questions are that need to be addressed.
As the 19th century dawned and the Industrial Revolution changed the nature of society forever, philosophical thinking would begin to take a new turn. Established beliefs would be challenged.